I'd ask you to reflect a bit today on what you ask of God. What are the things you ask of God? I can reflect in my life, and basically everything I've ever asked for, I've received. Everything. I don't know what else to ask for. Forgiveness is a big one. That's a just continual request, forgiveness. But in terms of tangible things, there's nothing that impresses me anymore. I mean, it's nice to have a newer car. We don't have to have a new car. When you drive it off the lot, it's old. You know, the minute you get a sporty car, they made a sportier car just waiting to come into the showroom. So material things, I guess when we're younger, we like material things. I think when people are younger, they want the bigger house. Then as we get older, we want the smaller house. I mean, it's a strange thing, isn't it? You know, people want that new car, and yet, oh, that first scratch, that kills you. The first dent, the first scratch. If you have a later model car, you know, an older car, you don't care if they push 3 shopping carts into it. You could care less. You may purposely bump the shopping cart just to get it out of the way, right? It's funny how those things are. It's strange what we ask for. So many times the things we ask for, you know, God's like, all right. And yet God knows full well it's going to create so much pain for us. We're that way. We're sort of strange in the things we ask for. Good people are that way. Now, on the other hand, evil people, they know exactly what to ask for. Herod's daughter, you know, the one who asked for the head of John the Baptizer, she knew exactly what to do. That's so incredible. I would have never thought of such a thing. I would have never thought to ask someone smarter what I should ask for. You know, I, and again, not to dwell on that, but it's just an amazing thing. I guess she had an opportunity, ask and I'll give you, Herod says. And so you would think, you know, a young woman would be squeamish about what was about to happen. Absolutely, like, oh my gosh, that's the last thing any civilized religious person, even in the time of the Jewish people, civilized and very religious, would ever think of doing. And yet, an opportunity. Evil looks for an opportunity. I think good people we are rather naive. We really are. I think we're naive because we do trust. We trust that the Lord is always there, so we just kind of keep asking. But I think it is prudent for the good, the holy, to be reflective of what to ask for. Jesus says, seek and you will find. But let's not waste our breath on things that are passing. Things that really, for me and you in a few years, won't amount to anything. We'll be so overcome in God's glory, we will never, I don't think, we'll ever reflect on, hey, that car we used to have or the car I wanted. That'll be so distant in our minds. It'll be so unimportant to us. It just won't come up because it's like, how banal is that, right? How trite is that? So be careful what you ask for. But what Jesus does promise us, he will grant us if we request. Let's not burden him with too many requests. So if we're just to ask for a few things, let's first ask for forgiveness. Forgiveness. Lord, forgive me for the times I offended you. I desire to be pleasing in your sight always. Lord, as you forgive me, and I prayed how many times, Lord, every day, therefore I want to forgive others the same way. Is it possible, Lord, to give me the grace to forgive as speedily, as quickly as you forgive me? Help me to do that. What do I pray for? What do we ask for? So we ask for forgiveness. We ask that the Lord will keep distractions. There's a lot of things that distract us. It's not always good things that distract us, but things that sometimes people who hurt us, I think that's a terrible distraction, because it's a distraction from reflecting on God's love and mercy. And so somehow we have to like get that out of our mind. You know, we still want to fight, and yet it's like that's distracting us from God. Satan loves that. If he can distract us more, how much better that is. So Lord, don't allow me to be distracted by others. Now we have to care. We're in the world. Remember, I said yesterday, we're not hermits. You know, we can't escape. There's no getting out. He has us here in this world for a reason. We are 11. But boy, it's so distracting, isn't it, to our own spiritual life? So Lord, help me not to be distracted. Help me to communion with or be with like-minded people who love you, who are forgiving, who try to focus purely on you. Help me to be in communion with them, those like-minded people who want to live the truth, who are not caught up in trying to disprove your truths, Lord. And I really believe God will answer those prayers so readily, because they serve God. God gets something out of that. Unless we're missionaries and need a new Jeep to get communion mass to far distant places, I don't think we need a new car, a new Jeep, really. Unless it's unsafe for your children, the one you got. We don't need those things. Unless the rain isn't pouring in completely. How often does it rain anymore, right? We don't really necessarily need a new roof, really. I don't need food. I really don't. Some of you don't either. But anyways, you know, there are certain things. Ask for what matters. Ask for what has value. Let us stand and pray.